Hello everyone, before we start this video, I want to mention that Squad is on sale for 40% off on Humble Bundle, and I'll leave a link in the comments, description, and at the top right of your screen. Once again, Squad is on sale for 40% off on Humble Bundle. I know you guys always ask me in the live streams and in the comments, Karma, when's the next sale? It's right now. It's September 8th, and it's going to be going on for about 2 weeks, I believe. So get Squad on sale for yourself or a friend for 40% off on Humble Bundle. So moving on to the actual video, this is going to be mostly a top 10 tips video, and I'm going to try to make these not generic. I'm going to try to make these unique tips that you might not have heard before, but these are my 10 tips to brand new players to Squad, and I hope, especially with the sale, that there's going to be a lot of new players, and hopefully these tips can kind of, you know, help you get, not necessarily an edge, but help you get over that learning curve a little bit faster. So the number one tip I want to talk about is learning how to use the range. The range is extremely important, and it's accessible to everybody. If you go into your main menu, you can see the range right there. You just enter the range, and once you enter the range, you have access to all the classes, all the emplacements, all the weapons, and even all the maps. The admin control to change the maps is admin change map, and then you can see all of the controls. So once again, if you want to take a look at all the maps, you hit tilde admin change map, and then you just pick a map, you zip on in. You can use the admin cam by hitting shift P, and you can go look at all the maps. You can try out all the weapons. You can try out all the vehicles. You can see all the emplacements. So the range is a great place where you, as a single player, can kind of get a grasp on Squad before diving into an actual multiplayer game. One of the other most important features of the range is the actual range, the actual firing range, where you can see the meter marks, the 100, 200, 300, and so on. The most important thing here is not necessarily to practice shooting targets, although that is helpful in its own way, but to be able to grab that distance, to be able to mentally mark in your mind where 100 meters is in game and where 200 meters is in game. That way, when you're making callouts like contact 300 meters, you have a better understanding of that distance. Or if someone else says contact 500 meters left, you know roughly how far 500 meters is in game. That's one of the most important parts of the range, in my opinion, in addition to all the assets and all the things you can try and test and see, you know, maps, weapons, vehicles, is the actual ability to see in-game range and to be able to practice, you know, gauging how far something is from you. The second tip I have is to start playing when you jump into the multiplayer is to start playing as a standard rifleman. You can take an optic. That's completely fine. Optics are good. But start as a rifleman. Now, the reasoning behind this, before you get into any you know, specialty weapons like the SAW or the LAT or the Grenadier, you want to be able to nail down some basics. And starting as a rifleman really lets you able to focus on yourself and on the core mechanics of Squad. Whether that be the sprint mechanic, the positions, you know, crouch, leaning, throwing grenades, using your shovel, very basic mechanics in the rifleman kit. And it's a non-essential role, so there's not too much pressure if you fail at your job or you do something that, like, if you make a mistake, it's not that critical of a role. Every squad member is useful and needed, but rifleman is just one of those that is more forgiving. but yeah, I would say pay attention to the simple mechanics as you play the rifleman, your sprint, recoil, and the objectives, how fobs work, learn how fobs work and how digging them works, and learn everything you can as a rifleman. Use your time as a rifleman to kind of just soak up everything about Squad rather than, you know, taking a LAT kit and now you're trying to like learn how to play LAT and then learn how Squad works at the same time. It can be a little overwhelming. So to kind of help that information overload, just pick a very standard rifleman class and focus on learning other things about Squad outside of your kit. But yeah, so after you've mastered the rifleman and you think you know how Squad works as a game mechanic wise with objectives and with fobs and stuff like that, then you can move on to other things like playing outside of yourself where you're playing more with the team. You're communicating with your squad. So this is tip number two, play as a squad. The game's name is Squad. It's not Lone Wolf, it's Squad. You gotta play with your squad because as you notice, Squad is extremely unforgiving. If you get shot and you're not next to anyone, that's it. You don't have a medic, you don't have support elements. If you're a rifleman and you see a BTR and you don't have that LAT kit, you're done. That's it, game over. So it's important that you play as a squad, because squads are built so that classes complement each other. You have strengths and you have weaknesses, and you complement each other. When the lat's taking a shot and he's lining up his heat, you gotta be able to cover him as a rifleman. Make sure that there's no enemy infantry that's gonna knock him down as he's taking that shot. If you're a grenadier, you're hitting those windows. There's a lot of different strengths and weaknesses in every class. Not everyone can do everything. It's built like that. That is the intention. So it's important to know how to play as a squad. Another thing is you start to realize that you fill a smaller role, not even as a single member in your squad, but a squad in the platoon in the entire game. And every squad has to work with each other. There's a lot of teamwork in squad, and that's why I think it's one of the best games out there, is because it really does force communication and teamwork. A lot of games say they do, like Battlefield or Call of Duty, but those are single player games almost. They're typically multiplayer single player games. You don't have to work with anyone, you just do your own thing. But squad is one of those only games where you are having to work with your team. So yeah, just realize the strengths and weaknesses of other classes and other squads and work together. Stay together because you're more versatile together. If you have the full squad together and consolidated, you can handle almost any threat that comes at you rather than spreading out and now everyone's kind of doing their own thing. And now if a BTR rolls up and your lat's on the other side of the compound, you're dead. So just make sure you stick with your squad, you listen, you work as a team, learn how to communicate and stuff like that. And that brings us to tip number 4, is communicating effectively. Communication, in my opinion, is like 60% of squad. 60% of squad is communication. And there's some tips I can give you when it comes to communicating correctly. And number 1 is make sure you're not blocking comms with non-essential information or chatter. It's okay to do that in local. The local chat. So there's 3 voice channels in squad. There's local, squad, and command. Command is only for squad leaders, so you don't need to worry about this at the get-go. Squad is for your entire squad, and then local is proximity chat. So squad comms. Don't block squad comms talking about the new dog you just got, or the lunch you just had, or, you know, how you burnt yourself eating hot tea or something. Just don't do that. Do that in local if you're going to do it anywhere. I don't even suggest doing it in local unless you're really far away from, you know, the squad leader, because he's busy talking to the squad leaders, trying to get the squad all organized, and you're here yapping about, you know, God knows what you're yapping about. So non-essential comms, and making sure that you allow that clear, concise information coming through the squad channels. Don't block the comms. Squad comms are vital. Another tip for communicating effectively is information needs to be relevant and easy to digest. If you give a long, drawn-out monologue and it's just filled with words that people don't use, and you're just... In Squad Ops, we teach this in SOTT Basic, and it's the ABCs. It's accuracy, brevity, and clarity. And these are really standard things for communicating effectively, even as a human being, right? Making sure that you're saying things that are correct, you're saying them fast, and you're saying them clearly, right? So making sure that you're saying things accurately, you're making it brief, and you're making it clear, because you don't want to be saying something that's incorrect in a long drawn out monologue, and you're mumbling through the comms. It's just nonsense. It's just total waste of everybody's time, and you get the squad killed. So make sure you're being accurate, brief, and clear. When you are asked a question, and when a squad leader is talking to you, or when you're talking to the squad leader, do not use the word I. I hate this. When I'm squad leading, and someone says, squad leader, I need this, or squad leader, I need that, or squad leader, there are guys on my body. Don't talk in the first person. Talk in the third person. That is the easiest way for squad leaders to identify what you are talking about. Because there are 9 people in a squad, and most of the time, all 9 of you, unless you're playing together every day, you don't understand or know each other's voices by heart. So if you say, squad leader, I'm over here, like, no one knows that. No one knows where you are, because no one knows who I is. So if I say, squad leader, Karma Cut needs this vehicle approval, then he knows, okay, Karma Cut needs the vehicle approval, or squad leader, he's on my body. Or you could say, squad leader, he's on Karma Cut's body. That way, when the squad leader looks at the map, he can see, okay, there's Karma Cut's body. He's on Karma Cut's body. Because if you talk in the first person, it gets extremely confusing because I'm just trying to line up whose voice is that? Who? Because I don't know who I'm playing with half the time. It's a brand new squad almost every round, unless you're playing with the same people consistently, which is rare. So talk in the third person. And the next thing is learning how to call grids and learning how to use the map and being able to communicate effectively. That's another thing I hate is when people don't use grids or when their callouts are irrelevant. So compass direction callouts work when you're next to the squad, when your whole squad is within like 50 meters of each other. The callout on the compass is fine because you're all within the same area, so the azimuth is roughly the same for everyone. But generally, when you make callouts, you want to give a point of reference. A good way to do this is using something universal, like the squad leader, or an actual land feature. So you could say, instead of saying squad leader, I have five guys pushing my body, or squad leader, I have five guys pushing Karma Cut's body, you could say, squad leader, I have five guys pushing the southwest of the cap. Or squad leader, there are five. There's a BTR to your north. That way, the squad leader can easily digest the information rather than trying to puzzle what you just said together, and figure out what direction, where, and how many. So using general points of reference, caps are very important to use, like the actual capture objectives, the squad leader himself because he knows where he is. Or buildings, or things that are that stand out, silos, storage centers, big things. So make sure that your callouts are, you know, using a point of reference that is, you know, relatively universal. And that brings us to number six, which is pick your fights. This kind of ties in with playing as a squad, like I said before, but you want to be able to pick your fights when you play squad. There are times when you don't want to engage, or not necessarily engage immediately. You want to delay your engagement. And a lot of players from other shooters, other FPS shooters, there's no reason to hold your fire. In COD, Battlefield, there's no reason to really wait. But in squad, you'll understand that the pacing of the game, there are opportune moments to attack or to defend or to do something. And you need to be able to, that only comes with time and experience, to be able to read the time and the opportunity. So you need to be able to pick your fights. You have to analyze the situation, and this goes more so for the squad leaders than for the standard rifleman. But as a standard rifleman, you should always be asking, if you haven't engaged yet, if your squad hasn't been in engagement yet, you should always be asking if you're clear to engage, because a squad leader might be trying to sneak you around a flank, and if you open up without asking and you get spotted, that just wastes a whole bunch of time and a whole bunch of tickets. So make sure you pick your fights and you clarify with your squad leader if you are weapons free or weapons tight. So just know that you don't always have to engage. Surprise attacks work, attacking from different angles works, and then making sure you're not like shooting small arms at a BTR, which is rated for like everything up to 7.62. Like making sure that you are engaging things you can actually destroy and actually have an impact on. Rather than, you know, wasting time and ammunition and tickets on things that wouldn't be effective. You know, that's a very vague statement, but like even for attacking caps, like you could attack the cap from that side, but you know, you're just not going to make any progress. So it's you got to analyze. There's a lot of analyzing in squad, a lot of reading the terrain and the pressure around the map. And that's a video for another time, because that's a whole topic. But yeah, know your place, time, and equipment when picking your fights. My next tip is to use your tools. As a infantryman, as a vehicle commander, as whatever it is, whatever you're doing in squad, use everything to your ability. Use the terrain, use your tools, use your other squad mates, use everything you can. Use the terrain around you, the cover around you. But more specifically, as a rifleman, or as a single player, you have smokes, you have grenades, you have bandages, and you have a shovel. If you see stakes that need to be shoveled up, dig it up. If you are getting pushed across a wall, use grenades. Like, a lot of players forget that they have these tools. And it's okay, because it's overwhelming in the time. And that just comes with experience, is knowing that, okay, I need to use everything in my kit here. I'm given these tools for a reason. I'm given smoke so that we can push objectives or block lines of sight. And use them. Don't forget that you have these tools, because it's very easy to forget that you have smokes and grenades and bandages, especially when you're new. All right, we're going to move on to tip number 7, which is learn the sounds. And I talk about this one on stream a lot, but you need to be able to learn the sounds and easily dissect what and where it is. That goes for gun sounds, vehicle sounds, footsteps, even fob radios, like digging sounds. Every sound in squad has a purpose, and it's incredibly important, especially since both like factions don't necessarily share the same weapon sets. Like if you have the US going against the insurgents, US is armed with M4s, and the insurgents are armed with like G3s and AKs. You need to know the sound difference, because if you hear an AK go off behind you, and if you're not trained to read that sound, you're not going to look behind you. You're going to think it's friendly. But if you can easily dissect what sound it is and where it's coming from, you can very rapidly adjust to that situation. And I see this many a time, even in squad ops, where certain players necessarily don't know the sounds as well as others. And it can cause some very, very, very tragic situations in operations. But yeah, just making sure that you are able to identify what and where it is. So take time. It's very hard and chaotic to do during a match, but the one way I always learn sounds of a game is I just go into a match and I just focus on the sounds. I'll play as best as I can, but the main thing I'm trying to go into the game focusing on are the sounds. Listening, okay, that's exactly what an AK sounds like. Okay, that's exactly what a BTR sounds like. Okay, that's exactly what a tracked vehicle sounds like. And then just learning, after you know all the sounds, learning how it sounds when it's a certain distance away. Like, okay, I heard a distant AK shot. That sounds like 500 meters away. And that information is huge. A lot of players overlook the sounds, but that as a squad leader, and even as a squad mate, sound is one of the most important pieces of information that I think are overlooked. So take the time to learn the sounds. It'll make you a better player, it'll keep you alive longer, and it'll let you kill a lot more people because you'll know exactly where they are. Moving on to the next tip is learn to take the initiative. We're getting into the more advanced tips here, but this is like learning to take the initiative is something that I think all players will eventually get to the point of, is once you know how to take or how to use your own kit effectively, once you know how to work with your squad, once you know the basics of squad and you have everything under control to the most part, now it's time for you to apply that knowledge, for you to execute on things that are given to you or things that you see are lacking. Whether that be, you know, pushing a flank, or even something as simple as when the squad leader says, I need a Logi driver. Jump in the Logi and do it. Because if you don't do it and no one does it, then you're not going to have a fob, and it's just going to be 30 minutes of just chaos and just agony as you guys just struggle. So just take it upon yourself every other match, or, you know, whenever you need someone to take the initiative, just do it. Just do it. Even if you're like, that's not really fun. But if you don't do it, no one is going to have fun. And hopefully we can kind of instill a culture within squad where, you know, people will swap off and people take the initiative and people just sacrifice one of their rounds so that, you know, the whole team doesn't suffer. And that's something I see a lot when there's a new influx of new players, is that a lot of players will kind of just not take the initiative when someone wants to back cap or get the fob down. No one will do that. And then the whole team suffers for the entire match. And then people wonder why they lose. It's you just got to be able to be selfless every now and then and understand that it is a team game. Like as we said before, squad is a team game. There is no way that you can always do exactly what you want in squad. It's not built that way. If you think that's how squad is played, you are absolutely wrong, and you're going to have a bad time, and you're going to cause a bad time for other players. That's what makes squad so great, is the teamwork and the ability to work together and make sure certain aspects of the entire platoon are covered. And that's what makes it great. It's what makes it worse sometimes is too, like, the community is the best and worst things about this game. Like I've said this multiple times and time before, and time again. But the community is the best and worst part of Squad, because depending on how your game goes and who decided to take the initiative and who decided to sacrifice is going to determine how shitty your game ends up being. Because someone either took that logic and said, all right, I'll handle the FOB this match. I will do that. I will handle the defense this time. Or everyone goes on attack and then you're all just struggling and just drowning for the next 40 minutes of the game. So it's the best and worst thing of Squad is when it works, but if no one works at it, no one takes the initiative, you're all going to struggle. So yeah, learn to take the initiative, whether it comes to platoon-wide things, whether it means watching security, watching the back. No one likes watching the back, but you need to do it, because if someone comes up the back, you're all dead. So make sure you watch your security, take initiative on the security, take initiative on the logi, on tasks, on positions, on engagements. Just learn to take it upon yourself to ensure that your squad does not get wiped or your team does not lose. Like, everyone has to pitch in. You can't just do what you want all the time. That's not how it works. If you do just do what you want all the time, no one's going to want to play with you, and you're going to get banned off a lot of servers. And this brings me to the last and final tip I have for all you new players, which is, once you've got the Rifleman kit down and you're taking the initiative and you learned all the sounds, you're good on the map, you know all the mechanics, and you have everything down, now it's time to play the other classes. And this is pretty much the last tip I have that's kind of unique, is playing all the classes. You might, like, play the Saw one time after playing Rifleman, and you're like, oh, I'm just going to main Saw, and I'm just going to Saw all the time, every game, all day. And that's cool and all, but you're missing out on a lot of information. You're missing out on not even a lot of fun, but just a lot of information. For example, if I only played the Rifleman kit alone, or if I let's take look at an example of if I played Squad Leader exclusively, if I never tried any other class, I wouldn't know how hard it is to shoot a lat. I wouldn't know the effective range it is to shoot a lat. I wouldn't know how many rounds a Grenadier has. I wouldn't know how much ammo a Saw has, or I wouldn't know how far the marksmans can see with their scope. It's important to try out these other classes, not necessarily so you can be a god at them all, but so you know the extent and capabilities of those other classes, and that when you're facing someone who has that kit, you know what they're loaded out with, you know what they can do, and you, as a player or as a squad leader, can adjust with that information and make the correct calls based on your experience playing that class. And I think that's extremely important. And that's something that I think is, the squad is 99% knowledge, whether it comes to communicating or anything you do. There's a very small amount of it that comes down to gun skill. Like, if you are in the right place at the right time, communicating effectively, working as a team, taking the initiative, and you're doing that all with experience, you'll beat out brand new players who are like CSGO gods and can one tap you from across the map, because you'll just be there at the right place. It's a very unique game in that sense. But yeah, make sure you play all the classes. You'll learn a lot about capabilities. Knowledge is power. Okay. Find the role that suits you, but don't let that stop you from being at least a little bit proficient in all of them. And that's pretty much all I've got. I know this was a little bit of a longer video, but I do enjoy making these kind of guides to kind of help players, and kind of, especially with the sale going on, I imagine we're going to get a large influx of brand new players. So anyways, thank you so much for watching. Remember, Squad is on sale on Humble Bundle for 40% off. So grab a key for yourself or for a friend. I'll leave a link in the description and in the comments. If you want to learn more about Squad, Squad Ops actually has something called SOTT Basic, which is a tactics and training course for Squad, and it's just very generic stuff. So drop on by squadops.gg to learn more about our programs, our training, and we host One Life events as well. So if you're interested in those, go ahead and stop on by. But thank you so much for watching. I'll probably come out with more and more guides as we move on, because I really do like sharing my knowledge of this game, especially with 1400 hours. And I don't know, I do enjoy these kinds of videos a lot. But anyways, let me know what you think in the comments below. Let me know if this helped you, what kind of tip or guide video you'd like to see next. And until next time, guys, see y'all later.